It was a small town, just like any other. Just like the millions of small towns that dot the landscape of this great nation of ours. Oh yes, it had its swimming pools. It had its main streets. It had its billiard parlors. And of course, it had its people. And so ordinary and so normal were these people that you could tell everything about them simply by looking at them. For example, you could look at that gentleman at the end there in the cap, and you could tell immediately what hope he holds in his heart, what hope he holds on to more than anything else in the world. He hopes for this. I'll count to three. You shout it out. One, two, three. I heard nothing. What did you say?
Oh, he's nonverbal.
Yes. He hopes that one day he will make that cry of his people.
Yes.
But will he? I don't. You could look at this gentleman here, and you could tell immediately that he has a certain job in this town. What is his job in this town?
I'm being farmer.
What?
Yes, his job is love. And you can look at this woman here, and you can tell right away that she has something, a possession that she holds on to dearly. What is that most prized possession?
Knife.
Cast iron frying pan.
A knife. Yes, that's right. Yes, my friends, it was just a regular small town, complete with
a man who one day wishes to make the cry of his people.
A man who is... apologies, what was that?
who is filled with the occupation of love.
Ah, yes, the occupation of love.
So much is he filled with it, he can barely remember.
And a woman whose prized possession is a knife.
Yes, that's right. As I say, folks, just a regular small town. Oh, and yet, there is one way in which this small town is not like any other town, at least not yet. And that is that only recently this town was invaded by zombies. But not your ordinary zombies, oh no. These are special brain-eating zombies from outer space with the uncanny ability to shape-shift and take on the form of the first human victim they devour. And therefore, at the start of our tale, nobody knows which of these seemingly innocent townfolk are in fact just a regular human being. Which one is the mythical zombie killer, the only one who has the power to destroy a zombie? And which of them are zombies? And so, my friends, the cards of fate are shuffled.
Well done.
My friends, sit back. Hold on tight to someone you love, because we are about to tell you a story composed with the entire alphabet of horror, in which A is for apocalypse, B is for brain buffet, and Z is for zombie.
Thank you.
we interrupt your regularly scheduled program, The Real Housewives of Trailer Park County, with this breaking news. Police are receiving more calls from local residents on the outskirts of town who are reporting strange activity from various people who they claim to be zombies. The sheriff's office is stating that these calls should not be a cause for alarm, for they are most likely Halloween pranks. Nonetheless, a few animals have been found torn from limb to limb. Also, two missing person cases have been reported in the town next door. Residents are advised to call in any strange behavior that they may encounter. More news at 11.
Well, Dr. Tom, I just know I've almost got your Bronco fixed.
Well, I'm happy that you've finally done it. I love this puppy.
I think I just need one more part and a little more time, and you'll be ready to go on your trip soon.
Amazing. Thank you so much. And you know what? We can call our consultations paid for.
That means so much to me, you know. Me and Mary, well...
Well, how are you doing? You haven't filled me in.
It's not looking good, Doc. I mean, I suppose...
Have you been doing your exercises?
Sure. I've been telling her how I feel, and she tells me how she feels. And then I repeat it back and say, what I hear you saying to me, Mary, is... And then she says, what I hear you saying to me...
Right.
But, well, last night I got home a little too late from the bar again, and...
Larry, come on. We talked about this. This is the reason that Mary doesn't want to continue having relations. Okay?
I'm afraid that maybe we're just doomed for divorce, Doc. We'd probably be divorced already if it wasn't for you.
Well, I'm glad that it's worked. Okay, Larry, but you have to understand that you're kind of ruining my stats.
Well, I wouldn't want that, Doc, especially since you're letting me pay for the sessions in automobile repairs.
You know what? That's fine. Have you thought about maybe, I don't know, taking a break from each other? Giving each other some space. You know, love is strongest when apart, or something like that.
Jeez, I don't know, Doc. We got married so young.
That's maybe the problem, right? You haven't explored yourself. I'll tell you what. Why don't you come with me on that trip, huh?
Really?
Yeah. Why don't you tell Mary that you will take some time apart from her? That you're simply going to go to Atlantic City with your doctor.
Well, I'm sure that if you say it's okay, she'll go for it.
Well, you know what I always say, right? You can't really
tell your partner
the truth
unless
you do it through
a doctor. You are so smart, Doc.
Oh, have a degree.
I'm going to double down and I'm going to get this Bronco fixed up for you.
Thank you.
In no time flat.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much. And we're going to go to Atlantic City, and you know what? We're going to have the time of our lives.
Hey, you go to Atlantic City every year, don't you?
I do.
It must be a very important place for you.
You know, it is. It's where I met Letitia.
Who's Letitia, Doc?
Well, Letitia was my first love. I can remember it now. She was my high school sweetheart, you know.
Just like Mary was for me.
Exactly. Which is why I've taken such an interest in you. You know, when we met, we decided to go to prom together. She asked me and I asked her at the same time. Can you believe that?
That's amazing.
And then homecoming came. Yes? We were both king and queen.
Wow.
Yes. It was like a magical story from the books. But unfortunately, things didn't quite work out for me.
Doc, I'm sorry to hear. Is that why you've dedicated the rest of your life to keeping couples together and helping them work it out?
Exactly. And I, as you know, I only take the projects that I think need it the most. Right? And I gotta tell you, I found myself really valuing our friendship above our client-patient relationship, or our doctor-patient relationship.
Me too.
You know?
I do.
Yeah. You want a beer?
I'd love one.
Well, I mean, you have a fridge here.
Yeah, help yourself.
Thanks.
So wait, you met Leticia in Atlantic City?
I did.
So you went to high school in Atlantic City?
I did.
So Atlantic City's your hometown?
That's right.
I've always wanted to see the hometown of the Love Doctor. We sure are lucky to have you here in our small place. I mean, I think it was just fate that, well, you were driving through town a month ago when your car troubles started and you decided to stick around a bit.
Yeah, you know what? This town has changed me. There is something charming about your town, something, I don't know, mystical about it. You know what I mean?
I do. I mean, I've never lived anywhere else, but
I know.
I've always felt like, well, this town was just a little dewdrop of heaven. Mm-hmm. Kissed by God. Why, nothing wrong could ever happen here.
Exactly. You just feel secure.
But that's why I feel even more pressure to stay married with Mary. I mean,
listen, this trip is gonna do you wonders. Mary will thank you. I promise you. Okay? Trust the Love Doctor.
I'll tell her tonight I'm going with you to Atlantic City.
Now come on, you two, sit down and let me tell you all how it happened.
Jake, I love your stories.
Telling you, this was the best game I ever played. There I was. It was already 1 o'clock in the morning. I was bone tired, and so were all the other players. They thought they'd have wiped me out hours ago, but I was luring them in, see? I was luring them in. Finally, it was the final pot of the night. There was $40,000 in
the pot. Oh my God.
$40,000?
I had to pull for an inside straight. Everybody else had folded, but Lionel stayed in. You see, he thought I was bluffing, kind of the way I bluffed him in last year's tournament.
Oh my God, Jake. Go on.
But this time I wasn't bluffing, see? I knew that God was gonna be on my side. I don't know how I knew it, Julie. I don't know how I knew it, but I just knew that God was gonna be on my side, see? So I let it all stay in, and the dealer took the card off the table. Boom, first card went to Lionel. Boom, second card went to me. I looked at just the corner, see? Just a little white corner where no one can even see the suit, let alone the number yet. And I peeked up, and I peeked up, and boom, an inside straight.
Oh! Oh, $40,000!
$40,000, Julie, can you believe it?
$40,000.
And so, what are you gonna do with it?
What am I gonna do?
What did you do with it?
What did I do with it? Well, you know what I did with it, sweetie. I immediately went down to the mortgage broker and I paid off the mortgage on this old house.
Oh.
That's
God, really was listening.
Now, don't you worry, Michelle.
Oh.
You'll get your break just like Julie and I have.
I'm happy for you. I am. And there's an extra room. It's in the basement, but it's beautiful, and if you need to, you could always stay with us, right, Martin?
Of course you can. Any sister of Julie is a sister of mine.
Do you really mean that, Julie?
Of course. Come here. You know what's special about this house, too? Look, I set up a table with tea. Remember how we used to have tea parties?
It was always fake tea. Now it's real.
It's real tea.
That's what $40,000 will do.
Oh, my God. It buys you tea. Oh, my gosh. Oh, this is the most special time.
Well, there's something else I want to tell you.
What?
Not only did we buy this house, but I'm actually going to open a little tea shop.
That's right. You see, I saved $10,000 that wasn't necessary to pay off the mortgage so we can take that little vacant place next to the billiard parlor.
That's so perfect. Well, I'm just going to be in your way. You need to get on with your lives. Don't worry about me. You know, I'll get a room down the street. It's okay.
Now, don't be silly. We want you to stay here. We love you. Why, sometimes I could just eat you up.
That is the sweetest thing anybody has ever said to me.
In fact, I feel the same way, and I think you should stay for dinner and then spend the night and come see your bedroom in the basement.
We would love to have you for dinner.
This is so incredibly special. Okay, I'll stay.
Get low. I hear it rustling. Give me the arrow. Direct hit. We're gonna have venison tonight.
Good job, Bob.
Yeah, now we'll just let it follow. It's gonna walk for a few miles and then collapse, and then that's when we'll capture it. How do you feel about that, Randy?
I can't wait till I can do it myself one day.
Margaret, how do you feel about it?
You're gonna let it suffer for miles?
Well, I can't go ahead and catch it. It's running off. Yes, I am.
Well, Bob, because you did that, I guess you get to make the sound of our people.
Yeah!
You call and they answer.
You know what? There's something I wanted to bestow upon one of you, actually, here. Being your uncle and all, and I know that I kind of raised you both, being that your folks, well, the tragic accident. But I only have this one bow of our people, and I don't know which one to give it to.
Well, being the oldest sister, I deserve it.
Well, you didn't really do much for your age, did you now, Margaret? You didn't? I don't mean that as an offense. I'm just saying being born at a certain year is not an achievement. You got to prove yourself with this bow.
But Uncle Bob, I know I'm 3 years younger, but my whole life I dreamed that maybe one day I could wield that bow and I could catch that monster that did away with our parents.
Well, we decided not to discuss those things here. I have an idea. You see that pine cone hanging right off there? Further down, two branches? Hold this, Margaret. Let's see you. If you shoot that down, the first person to shoot that down will get the honor of keeping the bow of our people. Ah! Direct hit! It's incredible, Margaret! It's like it's in your blood! Ha ha! There's another one right next to it there. Randy, why don't you give it a shot?
Bet you can't do it.
Come on.
Alright. So you said knock, and then do I bend the arm?
That's right. You gotta bend, you gotta pull it back.
Okay. Don't screw up!
No! Oh! Better luck next time, man. You gotta keep practicing, all right? Aww. Well, Margaret, looks like you got the bow for now. Here's an arrow.
Thank you.
You're gonna carry the family torch. But that doesn't mean you don't get a chance later, kid. I'm really proud of you, actually.
I knew it was gonna be me.
I knew it, too.
I'm the most athletic in the whole family.
The most athletic, the smartest.
Mm-hmm.
But Randy, you know, you're a good kid.
I'm a failure.
No, you're not a failure.
I couldn't protect our parents, and now I'm losing to my sister.
Your older sister, okay, man?
Who won the last year's pie eating competition? You did.
Only because it's pie. Nobody else wanted it.
Well,
what good is eating pie? I mean, we come from an honorable family. We have a lineage of hunters and people who go out into the woods, and when you get to make that kill and make the call of our people, that's what I yearn for.
Looks like today's not your day, little bro.
Yeah, you know, Randy, I hear the passion in your voice, and I know what you're trying to achieve in life, but sometimes that's not what we're called upon to do. What do you truly want in your heart? Is it just to be a hunter and killer?
Yeah.
So what I'm hearing is that you want to see the life drained from an innocent creature so that you can consume its fantastic flesh?
I don't think anything is innocent. I think all those animals out there, humans, bucks, whatever out there, there's evil in everyone's heart, if you look hard enough.
Well, that's kind of a pessimistic view of the world there, Randy. Margaret, what do you think about that?
I think there's good in everyone.
That's right! So do I!
Everyone has a little tiny slice of good.
Maybe that's why she's the one who hit her target, because she sees the world in a positive way.
Look, you can't just barge into my office like this,
oh,
Larry.
Doctor, I needed to see you right away. It's terrible. I've...
What? What now, Larry? Well, we leave tomorrow. What now?
I have to tell you, I failed you, Doctor.
What do you mean you failed me?
Well...
Here, have your bag. Breathe into it. All right. Now, easy.
All right.
What's the problem?
Well, I went home and I told Mary that I thought that we should take a break to find ourselves.
Good.
And that I was going to Atlantic City with you.
You haven't failed me so far. Go on.
And she got very mad.
Yes, I mean, that makes sense. That's part of the process.
She told me, well, that's just great, because I've been seeing Sam, the greengrocer, for the last few months behind your back. And now... If you want to go out and find yourself, well, that just gives me more time to be with Stan. And then she flipped me off. She said, eat me. And she stormed out.
Larry.
And she didn't come home at all last night.
Larry, I'm so sorry. This is not the idea that I had. Look, I promise you, my 12-step program works every time.
What step are we on, Doc? What step are we on?
We're on step number 3.
Oh my God, these are huge steps.
Larry, I'm really sorry, but you have to see it from my perspective, all right? I haven't failed once. And you're right, you kind of are failing me. Larry.
I tried, Doc. I cooled off, I went to bed, I thought, well, she'll come back in the morning. But then this morning, no sign of her. I called, I texted, nothing.
I'll tell you what, Larry, I will go for her. I will beg her to come back to you. I will tell her it was all my idea.
You do that for me, Doc?
Of course I will do that, Larry. Look at you, you're a mess.
I know, I just... Couldn't sleep at all last night.
Your hair is disheveled.
I know.
Your beard is long.
I know.
Your stomach a little larger than usual.
Okay, well. I just couldn't sleep. I kept seeing Stan's head on a pike. Oh, I was seething with anger. Can you believe it? She's been seeing someone else.
Larry, don't you worry yourself, okay? I will take care of this.
Thank you, Doctor.
Now, just stay here. You can stay with me. I've rented the upstairs apartment of the doctor's office, so you can just take my bed tonight, all right?
All right. I appreciate it.
All right. Good. Well, I will see you soon, okay? I'll be back with news.
Okay, Doc.
All right.
Martin, I'm in the basement. I can't find my knife.
Michelle.
Martin.
No. Just calm down, Michelle. It's only a knife.
I can't. It is not just a knife. It is my personal knife. Please, help me find it.
How long did you say Julie would be away?
As long as I want her gone.
Michelle, I don't understand. What is so important about this knife?
My mother gave it to me. Just to me. And she said it was my special time with this knife. We all get a special time with the knife. Julie had her special time. It's my time now, and I can't find it.
Julie and I have been married for 6 years, and she never mentioned anything about a knife.
Because it wasn't her special time. I just said it was my special time.
When was Julie's special time?
When she was little. She got it when she was a baby.
Your mother gave Julie a knife when she was a baby?
Of course! Didn't your mother give you a knife when you were a baby?
No, she gave me a pacifier.
Oh, well, There's nothing better than a switchblade to give to a baby. And I can't find it anywhere.
Michelle, is that it right here in this drawer, which is made of glass so I can see through it?
Yes. Oh, you found it. God.
You must have put it there when you were unpacking everything.
Oh, God. Oh, thank you, Martin. Okay, I can calm down now.
Anyway, I was just wondering, Michelle, if any of those help wanted ads that I sent to you sounded interesting.
None of them sounded interesting. I'd rather just stay in the basement, just looking over the help wanted ads, but doing nothing about it.
Well, don't you think it would be helpful if you at least came upstairs every once in a while? I mean, you've been down here for weeks now.
Well, helpful in what way?
Well, maybe you'd feel a little bit better. Maybe you won't stress out about just losing things. Maybe you'd go and get a job. That always makes people...
I feel good, Martin.
That's a really long blade.
Isn't it? I mean, what could be more helpful but being down here with a switchblade?
Well, you have to admit it's a little weird, don't you?
Weird? You guys down there?
Yes! Come on down, Julie! Julie, Michelle was just telling me about the knife.
It's my special time, Julie.
I know
that. Don't give me those eyes. I hate those eyes.
I know it's your special time. But remember, Mom said when it was your special time that you needed to use it very carefully.
Is careful, Julie. Oh, I'm sorry.
Do I need to keep it for you again?
No, Julie, I'm fine. Look, Martin was saying I could be very helpful downstairs in the basement, looking over want ads.
That's not what we talked.
No, that's not what I said. I was... Julie, come here. I think something is wrong with her. I mean, I'm a little surprised you never told me about this thing with the knife.
Oh, I thought she was all better.
Better? What do you mean? What was the matter with her?
She has some issues.
What kind of issues? Just tell me everything.
She has anger issues.
Anger issues?
Well, if she feels too stressed out or pressured, she tends to wield the knife. She's never actually hurt anybody badly, but...
What do you mean, badly?
Well, flesh wounds only. Really,
flesh wounds?
It's not like I can't hear you. Honestly, I have only hurt two people, and it was an accident. I flipped it open, and I slit their throat by mistake. Good. Everybody does that.
Michelle. Can you just put the knife in a safe place in your bedroom here, and let's talk. Now, I know that when you start to obsess over your knife, something is up. And I think I know what it is.
Oh, you know me so well, Julie.
I know you don't want to work.
I don't want to work. It doesn't look good for me when I work.
I know.
People don't like me.
Well, probably because you wield knives at them. But
I tell them I have a knife, and then when they say something to me I don't like, I just switch it off.
Okay, Michelle, that's crazy. You know that's crazy. We've got to stop this. You're going to work for me. It's going to be Julie and Michelle's country tea shop.
Do you really want that,
Julie? Yes. You're going to be the main waitress.
Now, look, I'm sorry. I don't mean to get in the way of sisters, but I'm not sure that's such a good idea. I mean, I've sunk a lot of money into this tea shop, and we've got to make it work. I'm sorry, Michelle, but we can't have you pulling knives out of the customers.
I'll be good. I won't pull the knife except at closing when
no.
I need people out.
Michelle, there's one little catch with this, and that is the knife stays home when you're at work. You can put it in the glass bureau. You can lock it. No one will come down here.
Do you promise no one would touch it?
Martin, do you promise?
Yes.
I promise.
Okay. Well, I'll keep it in there if you promise not to touch it.
Julie, can I talk to you upstairs for a moment,
Absolutely.
Please?
Absolutely.
Um,
I'm sorry I didn't tell you.
What is going on? We can't have her working like that in the store. She'll drive all the customers away. Julie.
I know, listen. It's a mess. I made a mess. I thought she was okay.
I make a living playing poker, right? And when you play poker, you learn to read people, Julie. You learn to read people really well. And I was looking at her eyes down there. Julie, I think something is wrong with her.
You mean more than I told you?
Yes. I mean, I think there's something evil inside of her.
Evil?
Everybody has a little bit of evil in their heart, Julie, but we spend our whole lives learning to suppress it. Sometimes, though, it can't be suppressed. And when it can't be suppressed, it has to come out.
What are you saying?
I'm saying I think Michelle has maybe reached the end of her line, and she's not able to suppress her evil anymore. And I think it's going to come out, and someone's going to get hurt.
Who?
That's my penitence for penitence. How do I say it?
I don't know either.
That's my punishment for losing our game.
Here, let me give you a hand.
You're so squeamish.
It's so gross.
I don't get how you're so good with the bow and can't even handle this. I mean, I've been cutting up his kills for years now without flinching. I can grab whatever organ I want.
Randy, I know you think this is so cool, but this is disgusting. I get so tired of blood and guts and the smell. It doesn't drive you crazy?
Well, when you're born into a family of hunters, I guess you just learn to get used to it. But you always had your ideas of going off, right? And doing something else.
Something more than just killing innocent animals that didn't ask for this.
Sometimes people ask to die by being born. It happens to all of us. What would you do besides hunting?
Some gathering, you know, have a garden, have some berries, and go picking apple orchards. That sounds so much more lovely than this.
An apple orchard. That sounds peaceful.
It's peaceful. You know what? I've thought about this a lot, actually. Do it out by Mom and Dad's old house, backyard. Have some apple trees, avocado trees, maybe some blackberry bushes.
I didn't even know avocados grew on trees.
They do. Big ripe avocados are just, so good. Uncle Bob has us off killing innocent animals, going through the woods. It's not for me.
Margaret, that bow has been passed down in our family for centuries. It means so much to me, and I don't understand why you're the one who can wield it, and you just want to be picking berries.
It's just a piece of wood and some string. Why are you so hung up on this?
I know it's just wood and string, but it's not what it's made out of that gives it value. It's, you know, the value that you put into it. To me, it's our family. It's everything. I'm glad you think that. Do you ever have nightmares about our parents?
I don't want to talk about that.
I still have them all the time. And I don't think they're ever going to go away unless I find a way to avenge them.
Hey, you two. I found you.
Hey, Uncle Bob.
I was going through the photo family album, and I came across this picture of you and Mom and Dad, the four of you together. I never showed that to you before.
Look at you at 2 years old.
Yeah, you were five, and I took that picture, actually. Listen, I want to tell you two that I'm really proud of you, no matter what happens. No matter how much pressure I put on you, Randy, Margaret, I've never had kids of my own, and never had a wife. You're my only family, you know, and, oh, that's a phenomenal job you did, Margaret. That's incredible how you cut her up and never thought that you had her, did you?
Thanks. You know me, I just love raw meat. No, Uncle Bob, this is actually all Randy.
You did this, Randy?
Chopped and filleted.
It's the best work I've seen. Well, anyway, as I was saying, I just want you to know that I was hard on you growing up. That's because I love you, and it's a hard world out there. You know this.
I do a lot. Are you leading up to something?
Just wanted to prepare you for the world. Not only physically, but mentally. Especially mentally. If you come across someone who doesn't want your best interest at heart, you're going to have to maneuver them. Not hurt them, of course, but the world is tough. And you got to... When you punch twice, it'll punch you back 10 more times. So you gotta toughen up. And that's why it's so hard on you, especially Randy. Because Margaret, I know she can handle everything. And this person, I've seen you do a dressing this beautifully. But I just want you to know that I care about you, but I worry about you. My only goal is to make sure that both of you can stand on your own 2 feet.
Julie! Julie! Julie, lock the door!
What's wrong? What's going on? Are you okay?
I was out. I was just taking a walk, and I walked through the woods, and I ended up by the old graveyard, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, that mound where those two people that were killed some years ago, Larry, that hunter kid, his parents, and Bob?
Oh, yeah, I remember now.
I was walking past there, and I heard this evil-sounding laugh, and I went closer to see what I saw, and I saw Michelle. Michelle was on the mound right by the graves of those two people, and she had that knife, Julie.
Oh, no.
And she was digging the knife in the grave and laughing like some kind of crazy woman, screaming out, "Ha, ha, 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 I killed you!" What do you think it means?
She's at it again. She's relapsed, Martin.
Do you think Michelle killed that poor boy's parents?
I don't know. But I'm really worried that maybe she did. And we gotta get her to a doctor.
Michelle,
she needs help.
Julie, I saw something else, too. After she left the mound, she walked off into the woods, and she was just standing there, just holding that knife and looking at it with an evil glint in her eye. And suddenly, a little rabbit hopped by. A white bunny. You know how you love white bunnies?
Oh, she loves white bunnies too.
She took the knife, Julie. She took the knife and she stabbed the bunny through the head. And she cut open its hide. And she reached inside. And she pulled out something small, either the heart or the pancreas. I could not tell.
I don't believe you. Martin, as sick as I've seen Michelle, she's never done anything like that. She's not evil. She's sick.
And then she ate it.
What is wrong with you?
With me?
She would never do something like that.
I saw her.
That would be a very sick, sick thing to do.
Look, Julie, I don't don't want to sound crazy or anything, but you've heard some of these rumors, some of the things on the newspapers about zombies.
Oh, great. You think my sister is a zombie?
Well, that's the whole point. You don't know who is and who isn't.
You're the one who said when we heard that newscast that it was kids. It was...
Well, that's what I thought. That was before I saw her kill and eat the rabbit heart or pancreas. I couldn't tell.
You're starting to make me really angry.
Julie.
My sister would never do that. She's just sick. And some people...
Julie, please, calm down.
...are just sick.
Okay. Calm down. Just calm down.
Okay, I'm calm.
You don't look very calm.
Well, I am calm.
Charles? You've been my confidant for the whole 2 weeks I've been in this town. And I appreciate you. You know that?
It's been a pleasure, Dr. Tom. Real pleasure to have you here. You know, me and the missus, we've been a lot better off for these conversations.
You've been doing your exercises?
Of course. 7 push-ups every odd hour. 12 sit-ups every even hour.
Yes.
Helping me lose the gut.
That's right. Very important. That's step number 5.
I made it, you know. Step number 3, when she had to leave me for 2 weeks, that was the toughest.
It's always the toughest. But here you are. Look at yourselves. You're about to get married. Again. But I gotta confide in you with something personal. I don't know what to do about it.
We'll just come out with it, Tom.
You know Larry, right?
Yeah. Good old Larry, the mechanic.
That's right.
You know, him and I went to high school together.
You told me? Yeah, he told me. It was one of our sessions. You two were, what do you call each other, Batman and Robin?
Yeah.
Decide which one's which?
Yeah. He stole my girl. Married her.
Well, this is awkward.
I'm not saying I'm happy that they're getting divorced. And
talking about marriage.
Problem. But, yeah, I'm not happy that he's divorced and married, but I'm not, you know. It's not very nice of me, is it? It's not nice of me at all.
About that thing I was going to confide.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, I thought it was our session. You tell me.
No, we can take a break from your session.
No, it's fine. Hey, I was being selfish. I hear you.
Well, this is strange now telling you from what you just told me, but he had asked me, or I had suggested that I go talk to Mary and beg her that she comes back to you.
And you worked it out with your silver tongue?
We worked out all right. Listen. Mary is a very beautiful woman.
I know, Dr. Tom.
Larry is a very good friend. And it was only a kiss.
No.
Right. It was much more than that. I'm ashamed, okay? Charles, I'm ashamed.
And you should be. That's a violation of...
You did the same thing. Wait, no, he did that to you. Got it.
It's a clear violation. Not only your doctor-patient, Magai, your friendship. You guys are friends, right?
I know that, Charles, okay? I gotta tell him, but I don't know how. We're going to Atlantic City tomorrow morning.
That seems like a terrible idea.
I know that.
I mean, I would lie forever. Just forever. That's what I would do.
You know, normally I am all for honesty with each other, with your partner, and communication, truth,
trust.
Set you free, trust. But you may be onto something.
You know, I think sometimes it's best just to let things go, you know? Not think about the past, not think about all the burdens of life, you know? Just let it go and be one with those around you. Sort of feel the vibe and the zen of what it's like to be in the unity, you know?
Yeah, you went to that convention, right?
Yeah. It was nice.
It's changed you.
You are glowing.
Thank you. I feel just so connected, you know, like I'm part of a greater whole.
You seem like so. Honestly, I sometimes wonder if you should be the love doctor.
Stop it.
Of course, I'm kidding. I'm the doctor.
You have cards and everything.
Documentation, yes.
Larry, are you here in your shop?
Bob, is that you?
Yeah. Oh. Sorry, I'm a little out of breath.
You need a drink?
Yeah. I just saw something in the woods, Larry, that I can't explain. There's no one else around, right? It terrified me. I've never been afraid, Larry. I've never been afraid. But I'm afraid now, and I don't know anyone else to confide in.
Well, take a seat. Ben the Ear, your friendly neighborhood mechanic.
Listen, I went out to scope for a new deer sit for next week's hunt, but I gotta cancel it. I know we had it set up, but I heard a sound I've never heard before in my life. I've been hunting ever since I was a little boy, but this sound, Larry, this was the most gut-wrenching, curdling sound I've ever heard. So I went to investigate, and there was a deer being eaten by some creature I've never seen before. There he is. He was just tearing it up with his hand in his mouth. It was a human being eating another deer, Larry.
Well, now, you know, sometimes out on the trail, the shadows can get a little funny. Are you sure? I mean, it was probably a mountain lion or a wolf or something.
It looked at me, Larry.
Well, mountain lions and wolves have eyes.
Not human eyes. Larry, you're not listening to me, Jerry!
Okay, it was a man! Take a breath. Did you recognize the man?
No! Just covered in blood from head to toe. I've always thought I was the brave one. I thought I could carry the family blade and name and the family bow, but I had this fear. I never felt this afraid before, Larry. Help me, damn it.
Okay, yeah. Hey, now just try to calm down. Oh, I know. Now, Bob, what I hear you saying to me is that you are feeling a fear that you have never felt before.
What the hell is wrong with you?
I'm communicating with you, damn it. It's the second step.
There's only one thing I came here for you to help me with, and that's for you to get the two shotguns. We're gonna go back out there and kill that son of a bitch.
Well, wait a second. We're not gonna go charging into the woods.
I have to! I have to prove myself and have no fear!
Bob, what is this really about?
What's it really about?
This is about your brother and his wife.
Yes.
That tragic night.
I saw something like that over their body. And I couldn't help them. And I failed them. They died because of my cowardice.
You gotta stop blaming yourself for that.
I can't! I'm the hunter of the family. I'm the one that knows how to shoot and kill. And I couldn't do anything.
Now, Bob, no one really knows what happened to them that night. I think you're in shock.
If you're not here to help me, then I'll just get the hell out of here.
No, I'll help you. All right. Here are the shotguns. Okay, now be careful. Let's keep the safety on. Now, why don't you lead me out and show me that deer?
Let's go.
And we'll check it out.
Jack home?
No. There's no one here right now, just me.
I got the key.
Why do you have the key?
Well, he's one of my clients. He was very thankful when I did the work that I do for him. I feel you are distressed.
You're a therapist, aren't you? I know that. I can tell.
Excuse me?
No. Well, I've been to many.
I'm not a therapist. I'm a love doctor.
Same thing.
All right.
You're a love doctor.
Yes. But I can see you.
Can I just tell you something?
Yes, please.
I love my sister so much. And I feel like I'm getting in the way of her marriage. And I don't know what to do about it. I'm pretty sure that her husband thinks I'm crazy, but I'm not. I'm just crazy in love with my sister. And I don't want to hurt her. I don't want to hurt anybody. I just want to live in a basement and play with my knife and just be one with the dark anything. And don't you see? I'm not invisible here.
This was not in the manual. I will improvise. Look, we all have knives, metaphorical knives, that we use to keep our loved ones away.
I have a real one. I keep them away with that.
I was hoping it would be metaphorical. Okay, we all have real knives and metaphorical knives that we use to keep our friends and loved ones away. Yes, we like the darkness of our own souls to hide ourselves from our true feelings. Yes?
Yes.
Sometimes one must let go. You know? One must continue to hide oneself forever, as to not be discovered for the fraud they are. You know what I mean?
I think so. I think what you're telling me is don't hide yourself so that people can really see who you are. And if you have a knife, you should pull it.
You're paraphrasing, but close enough. Do you want to tell me anything else? Or shall I just wait for Jack?
Well, I have nothing more to tell you unless you have something to tell me.
I do not.
Oh. Hi.
Jack.
Yes.
Wanted to return the key.
Thank you. My name is Martin.
Should have written that note.
You're a good doctor, but a faulty memory.
Yes.
I wonder if I might just have a moment with Michelle.
Of course. This is your house. I'll see you in our sessions, all right?
Michelle.
Martin.
I told Julie that I saw you on that hill with the knife, stabbing the mound, eating the rabbit. But you don't have to worry. You're not going crazy. You didn't really do those things. You see, I know that you didn't really do those things because I did.
Oh, no.
You see, I'm not who you think I am.
Martin, wait.
I've waited long enough, Michelle.
No, you have it all wrong, Martin. You do have it. Seriously. All wrong. And it isn't supposed to be like this.
What?
What's going on?
Oh, Martin.
Save yourself. I don't know what's happening.
What do you mean? I dropped my pipe.
Sorry. Martin brings me out. That's all he said to be yourself. Be yourself.
No, I said hide yourself.
No, you
hide
said
yourself.
Be yourself. You said be yourself.
No, I most certainly
no,
said.
You said be yourself.
Okay.
So, be yourself. Be yourself.
Is that a finger hanging off of your?
Oh, God. Oh, you don't get it. You just don't get it.
I don't get what? I don't get what?
I'm going to be myself. I'm going to be myself. Yes. Yes.
Stay away.
I can't stay away.
I'm the law doctor.
And I would love to use this knife on you, but it does me no good when I'm feeling this way!
And so, it begins.
More breaking news. Police have been receiving more panicked phone calls regarding zombies. A few missing person cases have been reported in our little town, as well as more grotesque animal mutilations, where animals have been found half eaten, dismembered, torn, skinned alive, and severely crumbled. Police are advising that all residents stay indoors until further notice. I, for one, plan on going home to my delicious wife and child in order to enjoy a delicious meal. More news, Ella.
Right here. You see the carcass, how it's torn?
I see a dead deer, Bob. I do.
You see a dead deer? His head is clean off its body.
That's Where's right. his head? Something ate it. Something ate that deer head.
Yeah, we're going to find what that something is and take care of it.
All right.
You know, Larry, I don't think that you're taking this too seriously.
Listen. We've been hunting these woods since high school. We've come across dead skunk, dead possum, dead deer a time or two. I just never seen you this spooked before, that's all.
It's because I saw what was eating, goddammit. There has to be some sort of clue. Turn this flashlight on.
Wait a minute.
This is a tooth. See, a human tooth! A molar, no less!
Now, hold on a second. There could be any number of explanations for how that got there.
There's a bite mark in the human molar right on it!
I don't know. You're starting to freak me out here, Bob.
Oh, really?
Yeah!
Well, I am freaked out, Larry. Larry, you know what? You know, we've been friends for, all our lives. And I'm surprised that you're behaving this way, actually, by now. You've always had my back. And now you're making me question my own sanity.
I don't mean to do that. I'm sorry. It's just, ever since Mary left, I haven't been myself.
I haven't been there for you in your hard time. I get it. And I'm sorry for that.
No, that's all right. I know how you felt about Mary. You right. thought she was a bad person.
Yeah.
Never wanted me to marry her.
No.
Told me that on our wedding.
That's right. And you did anyway. And look what pain you're feeling right now. You gotta listen to me. I know things. I've seen so much in this life.
You're a good judge of character.
I sure am.
But, well, I loved her and my heart wants what it wants and now I'm a little worried because I haven't seen her in a few days.
Lord!
Oh my god! Larry, Bob, it's me.
Charles,
how do we know it's you? You used to pee your pants in the first grade.
Damn it.
And you sucked your thumb.
Alright, okay, it's you. It's Charles.
Good Lord.
Charles, I saw some.
What are you guys doing?
Godly creature eat that deer.
Bob says he saw a woman eating a deer.
I think it's one of them zombies we were talking about on the radio.
Ah. Oh my god.
What was that?
You look at that? Look, and this is what I found. Look. A human molar.
Oh, don't keep it in your pocket.
It's evidence, damn it.
It's human. And it's a molar.
Yes.
Listen, there's something going on here. You were supposed to go with Dr. Tom, and he's disappeared. I went to go... He had relations with Mary.
What?
Take this gun there. I have a small one for you.
Wait. The love doctor?
He loved on Mary.
Yeah, I'm not Mary.
That was not the point, but it kind of is the point.
After all the fixing on his car I did!
I'm sorry. Larry, I'm sorry. You know, Mary's been a wedge between all of us in this friendship, and maybe it's best that you move on from her.
Yeah, to hell with her!
You know?
You don't mean that!
Of course I do!
I pined after her for a time, and we barely spoke for years after you guys got married.
And I pined after her, too. But she's a... Jezebel.
She's a Jezebel.
A Jezebel, that's harlot.
But, well, she's missing and she may be in danger.
And so is Dr. Tom. Right underneath his Bronco, there was the hood.
What?
Blood on the ground everywhere.
I'm telling you, something's going on in this town. We gotta stick together. I said we go to the cabin. Now.
Yeah, we got supplies there. Let's do it.
Julie, you and I haven't been up here in our secret spot for a long time.
Well, it's needed, isn't it?
It sure is.
I'm sorry I got so crazy about the show.
Oh, that's all right. Why don't I get a fire going here in the fireplace? You know, this used to be easier to find the cabin. Now all the trees are overgrown so badly.
I like it. It's kind of like we're in a green cave, you know?
Things are starting to get a little crazy out there, don't you think, Julie?
Oh, they're very crazy. They're so crazy.
Julie, you know how much I love you, don't you?
Of course I do.
There's only been one other woman I was ever attracted to, but after I broke up with Mary.
There's something I never told you.
What?
I was with Mary as well.
That girl.
That Mary. Something about her. But what were you going to say?
Well, now it's me and you.
Yes.
Just like in our wedding picture, right?
Yeah. I love you so much. And you know what?
What?
I would love you no matter what.
Really?
Even if you acted like Michelle, I'd stick with you.
Would you stick with me, Julie, even if I wasn't exactly what you thought I was?
Would you stick with me if you found out I wasn't what you thought I was?
Yes, I would.
Well, yes, of course. We love each other. It doesn't matter.
What if something there was inside of me was really, really bad, like really bad?
I can't imagine. But even then, I would love you, and I would expect that you would love me, even if I had, like, really bad habits, or maybe something deep, dark, and horrible in me.
Well, isn't that what life really is, Julie? It's knowing that there are these horrible things within us, but struggling to keep them under our control.
Exactly.
So we can live and love and be happy.
Exactly, and that's why I love you so much, because you understand that, and we share that, and we work so hard to keep our love contained.
Look at me, Mark! There's a lot. Mark! It's me, Bob!
What?
Open the cabin door! Hurry!
Whoa, what is going on here?
Listen, we're going to go to the main cabin just on top of the hill. I want you two to join us. I'm so glad your light was on. We got you here. We need provisions.
What is happening? Why? Where? What are you doing with all these guns?
You been listening to the radio much lately?
No.
They say there's zombies out there. A wave of eating people alive.
That's right.
Turning them into a mindless horde.
Look, I found a human molar.
Good catch.
My God, it has a cavity. It's not the fact that it's a molar that's interesting. It's where we found it. In the carcass of a mutilated deer.
Deers don't have molars.
No. A human ate that deer.
Yeah, and I caught a glimpse at this creature
consuming this poor innocent animal.
Why, that's horrible.
Yes.
You couldn't be.
I can't help but remark on the irony that you're an avid hunter and yet you are creeped out by something eating a deer.
It changed me at that moment.
Did it?
I'm not a hunter anymore.
Are you going vegan now?
That's right. I'm not eating any more animals after I just saw what I saw. When I looked at the...
Join us, brother.
Oh, you're vegan?
Yeah. They got beans over there. It's okay.
When I looked into the eyes of that creature eating that deer, something came over me. I was awash with the sense of fear and guilt and disgust.
Look. I'm sure we're just letting our imaginations run away with ourselves. Look,
Wait, no! Was it Michelle?
I don't know who it was.
We don't know the deer's name.
No, listen.
Why did you think what you said?
Listen, I didn't go by your house. I was looking for Dr. Tom, and his Ford was outside. And I went in. There's a blood streak going past the Ford Bronco. And inside your house, there's a puddle of blood that looked like liters and liters just leached out on the floor. And there wasn't anything in there, except for this human inside.
Oh, God.
Michelle!
Hi, it's Michelle. You recognize her inside?
We're twins. Sort of.
Michelle! All this talk, I forgot about Randy and Marvin. I didn't find them.
Okay, wait. Why? Julie and I know this area very well. Why don't the three of you stay here, and we'll go scout around, and we'll let you know if we find anything that looks suspicious or dangerous.
Yes.
And we'll go look for Michelle. I mean, maybe she's really in danger somewhere.
All right. Lock up.
Well, you just stay here. I just get Margaret and Randy, okay? You two stay here.
All right. We'll start.
I'll make some chili.
Secure in the cabin.
Vegan chili?
You know, I am starting to explore about myself.
All right.
I think I might be a vegan, too.
Okay.
I need the bow.
Not this again. Look, when you go for revenge, you need to dig two graves, okay? You need to let it go. Mom and Dad are gone. You had it so in your head that it's your fault. You could have done something. You need to let it go. People die. It happens, okay?
How can you be so cavalier about our parents?
Not cavalier. I just know.
I'm in your room. You don't have a single picture of them. You have that bow on the wall, but it seems like you just want to bury everything down and pretend like it never happened.
I do, okay? I want to bury it. It makes no sense. Why they died, how they died, okay? And I would rather just bury the memories than confront it and think I could do some thing to avenge their death. It doesn't bring them back.
Uncle Bob told us what he saw. No matter how outlandish it seems, he saw some sort of creature. Maybe not a man or a woman, but something that looked like one, standing over their bodies.
So what? So there was something standing over their bodies, okay? People see ghosts all the time.
Have you been listening to the news?
Not this again. There is nothing you can do to bring Mom and Dad back, okay? Nothing. You know what? I'm so sick of you asking for this. Just take it.
Oh, thank God you're here. You gotta come with me to the cabin right now.
What's happening?
I found a human molar. Oh, damn it, I forgot it.
I don't want to see it.
I saw a deer being killed by some ungodly creature, and I'm gonna dare say it was the same thing that killed your folks.
What was I just telling you? We gotta go after him.
There's something I didn't tell you two. A secret that I've been keeping, and I've got to get it off my chest right now before it eats me up. Metaphorically speaking. I saw what killed your mom and pa.
Yeah, the mysterious figure.
The mysterious figure, and I had the bow in my hand, Randy. And I couldn't do it. I was so petrified with terror that I couldn't pull and save them. And they're dead because of me. But I'm not going to let you two die. Not on my watch. I made a promise.
You had the bow in your hand?
That very one.
So it's your fault.
You could have saved them and you didn't?
You let our mom and dad die. And now we're orphans.
Forgive me. But I raised you. I didn't know what to do. I was also just petrified with fear.
You're a coward. We are orphans because of you.
No. Because of that creature. I could...
Get out.
No, you gotta go.
Get out.
Jimmy.
You don't know how to use it.
At this range, I do.
Well, what about this range right here? Go ahead and pull it back.
Okay, guys, just stop it, okay? Look, it's not your fault they died, but you could have stopped it. And we talked about this, Randy. Nothing you can do can bring Mom and Dad back, okay?
Listen, just come with me to the cabin. You can hate me for the rest of my life. If you want to kill me there, but we gotta go to the cabin now.
What's better than hanging around with her? Fine, I'll go.
Don't you talk about your sister that way. You apologize to her.
I don't have to apologize to anyone.
You know what? I'm going too. Because somebody needs to know how to use this bow, since the two of you can't.
Martin!
You think?
All right, I suppose you know.
I knew when you busted in on the love doctor when I was going to kill him, but I needed more therapy first.
Yes, I feigned fear in order to leave you to him, but I must confess, you pulled off this human disguise for all of these years quite well.
As did you. It was impressive, don't you think?
Yes.
With my sister, no less.
Zombie Thumb.
But I'm going to ask you now, Martin, as a small favor to me. You leave my sister alone.
I have been priming her for so long.
I have been priming her for longer.
You think you're going to swoop in on my prey?
Yes.
You have another guest coming. I married her. I lived with her. I love...
Say it.
I love to think of her cooking in stew.
That's my point. If you had been with the love doctor, you would know what love is. And I was just going to find out.
Listen, all right. Yes, I fell in love with her. I have committed the most heinous sin a zombie from space could commit. I fell in love with a human. And yes, I thought for a time I might save her. I might devour the entire world, but leave her alive. Yet, I have realized I cannot. I am what I am. And just like the scorpion will always sting the fox before it reaches the other side of the river, I will always kill a human.
So that's a no, then. You're not going to save my sister.
No. But you... How is it that you can think of saving her? Doesn't the hunger rage within you?
Yes, it rages within me. But she is my twin, sort of.
What the hell does that mean, anyway?
We're Irish twins. It means I still feel what she feels. But we were born
at different times.
You are not even this human carcass you wear, but look how you have taken on its life.
I feel it. Don't you see? I feel it. I want to kill her myself.
Yes.
But I want her to live. Oh, Michelle! You found Michelle!
Oh!
I thought, Julie, you were dead. I thought you'd been killed by...
No, I just left my molar.
Your incisor.
Yes.
Here.
Do you have it?
Oh, yeah. Thank you
for finding her.
Julie, it's so good to see you.
You too. Martin.
Julie. I need to leave.
No, you don't. Say what you have to say to me. You've been trying to tell me something for so long, and now that I know Michelle's okay, why are you looking at me like that?
Do you really want to hear the worst of it?
Of course. Very good!
Doesn't this true form repulse you? What?
I
can wait. Oh, for someone, I knew it. So glad.
Melted.
We are meeting now. Sisters. Husband. Are you happy? Now?
How could I not
be together?
No!
But you're not that smart. And how could you know? None of us can know until we're revealed.
But then you and I could live and love each other the way these humans do. Love like we never experienced it.
No! Zombies.
Let us in! Open the cabin! Are they there? Are the three guys there or not?
Larry!
Tom! Yeah. Sorry, we tried with
the chili's on.
We nailed the door shut. I'm sorry.
Do you guys have any bay leaves?
No.
No bay leaves.
No bay leaves.
Oregano? Why? Because it's meat and it needs flavoring.
Here's some venison.
Never. Oh, by the way, I'm a vegan now. We're all here, we're safe.
Did you see anything on the way out?
No, nothing. Do you hear that?
Yeah, they're out there. The radio's all static.
It's a shotgun.
The TV, all the stations are down and there's no cell reception.
Do we have any more shotgun shells? Any more weapons? Anything?
Only what we have here in the cabin.
I have my bow.
And I have 7 arrows left.
That's what you gave me. 2 shells in here. And there are only 11 shells in this box. I can make the chili extra spicy. Sure.
Uncle Bob, you said in emergencies, if anything like this happened, that we should not trust anyone outside of the people that are with us. Do you trust?
That's a really good idea. You know, I've known these guys since I don't know, grade school, and you kids your whole lives. Everyone stand back now! Get in the line! Whoa.
Easy, Bob!
Get in the goddamn line!
You stand back!
You get in the line!
Stand back.
No!
Wait a moment, just put your weapons down. Let's just hear him out, okay? Uncle Bob, tell us what to do. Charles?
There is way too much testosterone here.
Just listen to his plan. He's smart.
I just want everyone to sit in their own chair. And I'll sit in mine. Can I have a rocking chair?
Why don't you eat your salad?
This is silly, Bob.
One of us will be one of those creatures. I heard about them.
They've changed forms. Don't you guys know anything?
Uncle Pop, we're your niece and nephew.
This is something one of those creatures would say.
Have you
ever wondered why is it you're always the one mysteriously finding the creature over the victim?
Because I'm the hook!
You saw their parents get murdered mysteriously. You saw that deer get murdered mysteriously. How come you're always in the wrong place at the right time, Bob?
Larry, you don't know what you're talking about.
You know, Larry, that sounds like zombie talk to me. Putting 1 + 1 together equals 2? Only a smart zombie would say something that clever.
Oh, you've known me my whole life. You know I'm not smart.
I know.
You know why I know? He didn't kill him because he's a coward. He can't kill anything but a deer. Isn't that right, Uncle Bob?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Now you're a vegan.
Now maybe it's time for calmer heads to prevail. What do we know about these zombies? We know they have loose teeth, for one. We know they like meat.
I'm a vegan, so I'm out.
Margaret, I mean, you studied anatomy in college, right? When you went away for a few years. Do you have anything that we could use to maybe tell if someone was one of them?
They take the form of other humans. There'd be nothing different.
Come on, you must have learned something. You spent $100,000 on that fancy university.
They don't teach you about zombies in college, okay?
Wait a minute. I do know something about thermodynamics. It takes a certain amount of thermonic energy to shift from cellular structure to a different corporeal form.
But wait a second, you just said zombies were smart!
Yes, but I'm not that smart. I just read about it in a book.
Okay, Uncle Bob, keep going. Let's see if we can figure out its
thermal energy to change.
Listen, I have to wait for deer. A lot of time on my hands, so I read things.
So we need heat, thermal energy.
Yes, they give off a lot of heat. That's what I'm trying to say. Anyone have a thermometer?
We got this meat thermometer.
That's the only thing that'll work, but it has to be done rectally.
Why is that?
It's just more accurate, damn it.
Okay, this is going crazy.
What temperature would a zombie be?
120 degrees exactly.
Pretty hot.
It's very high.
Yeah, it'd be hot to the touch. You wouldn't need a thermometer.
Well, I don't know, Kevin!
Uncle Bob, why
are
your teeth so red? You're sweating bullets.
I am sweating because I'm scared. I'm not a zombie, damn it. We need more food. I'm going to go to the back shed and grab some.
Wait, someone should go with you. Someone brave.
I'll take a volunteer.
I'll go.
Food. I don't want this chili to burn.
You too know my uncle since grade school. You don't think that's a zombie, right? That took over his body?
It couldn't be, right? It's a ridiculous idea.
He used to pee himself every day in first grade.
We just came up with that plan to test our temperature, and now he goes running off. I mean, I'll stick whatever you need up there and tell you whenever.
Maybe you should go check on him if you're that worried about him. Nobody knows him better than you. He basically raised you like a father.
And if he is one of those things, then your sister might be in danger.
You're right. I should. Wish me luck.
Good luck.
Okay. This has to be some. Yeah, I got it. Canned corn, canned beets, god damn. We can really use a steak right about now.
I thought you said you were a vegan.
I am. I take some time to adjust.
Uncle Bob, you really did see those things, right?
I did. Randy, what are you doing out here?
I was just checking on you two.
Here, have some canned beets.
Uncle Bob,
I have a thermometer here. I'm going to prove it to you. I'm going to go out back and prove it to you. to the outhouse.
Can we just turn around?
I need privacy.
I feel like an oral thermometer would be easier.
Is that one of them?
You can't go on!
Uncle Mom!
Uncle
Mom!
You see, not yet for you to read. I'm not a zombie.
Well, how do we know you?
Oh.
Well, I was gonna ask how we knew you stuck it where you stuck it, but I can. Can you wash it off?
Guys, we're a family, okay? We're the only family we have. We have to stick together.
What about those other two? Uncle Bob and me? Are either of them,
I don't know,
acting strange?
Larry's being more forceful than usual, but also he's been questioning me a lot lately, and that's never like him. Usually he's right on the ball. I trust you, I believe you, and now he's all cooped up in his own head. That's different.
I know we have our differences, and I said things that I meant, but were a little harsh, but maybe we should stick together as a family and interrogate those two.
That's the only thing I ever wanted.
We should use those tools that you taught us, sneak up behind them, maybe tie them up.
What do you mean you don't love me? We have the whole world ahead of us now. We are both of the same kind. We could have everything we always pretended to have. Julie, I was not pretending. I fell in love with you.
I thought I was in love with you too, but only as a human. Although, need doctor, we love we're here to help us.
Because he's here! I love you.
I feel when you are a zombie, I just don't love you anymore. You were cuter as a human.
I like when you wear those onesie pajamas. Are you willing to commit to being human for the rest of your life?
Can it be done?
Yes. Is that what it would take? If I completely suppress the zombie in me and live my life always as a human, will you love me?
Dr. Love, is that really love? If he has to pretend to be something he's not, even though it's better.
That is a sacrifice that he's willing to make for the relationship. It is giving of yourself. Think of it that way.
No more eating people's limbs. No taste of blood.
And you would...
Just a minute, I'm hungry. Zombies taste bad.
You would do this too?
No.
But
you have to be a zombie-ish. Not. No zombie for you. I stay a zombie.
I mean, I've been disguising myself as a human for so long, who's to say that's not all a human really is?
Maybe you're smarter than I thought.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yes.
Yes.
Maybe I don't have to pretend to be a human. Maybe just by standing upright and wearing these expensive clothes and living a respectable life and keeping the zombie deep down inside, maybe I really am a human after all.
I like that talk.
Okay, I got Larry tied up.
Put him down.
Okay.
What are you doing?
Marvin, bring in Charles.
I got Charles.
Somebody's hurting the chili.
I got the thermometer. Now we can do this the easy way or the very awkward way.
Do what you have to do, I guess.
Margaret? Randy? I can't do this.
They're your friends. It was your idea. I said orally.
It's too big to fit in the mouth.
I'm not putting that in my mouth now.
Just give me the...
All right. Just add a few degrees and put it in the armpit.
Does someone want to volunteer to go first?
I've got nothing to hide.
Do you want to go out back? For privacy?
Let's just... We're in a cabin eating beans. Come on.
Put away!
If that reads anything other than 98.3 degrees.
Read it.
98.3! Right on!
Good. Red.
Oh, don't keep the red.
Charles, I have nothing to hide, but I do want to say that I feel like my trust is betrayed. When was your anal exam?
All right, hold your breath.
You know what? For a long time, I believed that human beings were bad and that they could never change. Oh, thank you. We're above all this.
Read it.
Don't you see?
98.7. It's a little
warm. Here.
What? I see some figures outside.
Can't you hear them coming?
They're circling the cabin!
Look, we're...
They're everywhere. No. Don't you see? I was with Mary for a long time, and she was with pretty much everyone around town. And I just thought that's what I deserved. That I was just, you know, a lowly human, and... But then the love doctor came into my life, and he taught me. I think that's why he wanted to take me to Atlantic City. He wanted me to dress up nice and walk around a fancy casino and eat a steak dinner and see that I can elevate myself beyond a small town mechanic. He believed in me, and I believe in all of us.
I believe in you.
And I believe in you.
I believe in you, too.
And I believe in you and you.
But nothing's more important to me right now than your forgiveness, you two. Do you forgive me for letting your parents die?
Tough ask.
Fine. Take the gun.
Don't you see? Just because one day you were paralyzed in fear doesn't mean that that's how you are the rest of your days.
You're right. And I'm not going to let fear control me anymore. I'm going to sacrifice myself out there.
Oh, my God!
That's the only way, damn it!
We're going to go fight off the zombies.
No! You're a vegan!
Sorry, you mean I can't fight? I just don't eat meat!
Come on!
Okay.
Uncle Bob, we said family sticks together. I'm the best shot here. You've got to take me with you.
No!
I'm sacrificing Randy, myself!
Margaret!
You stay here, okay? You need to be here. I need you to be safe.
Do you want to do a family thing? Should I stay here?
Why don't we all just stay here? We've got to stick together. That's my point.
If we stay here, we're sitting ducks, okay?
Wait. What? Shh, the power just went out.
my flashlight battery's dead.
Oh, we have a candle. It's cold in here, though.
All right. Wait! Don't go in there. Look at them. Look at them through the window. How scared.
Huddle together for warmth.
How quickly they turn on each other. How easily they shove that large thermometer up their ass.
No, Julie!
Listen, they are flawed. We are flawed. But we can overcome. Julie, be human with me. Don't sink back into that horrible life that we've finally been able to overcome. We do not need to live by devouring the people with whom we share the planet. We are better than that. Be better than that with me, Julie. Please, please love me and be better than that.
Charles! Larry! Come with me!
You should
stay here.
I'm gonna go to the power.
I'll be right back. Please!
All right!
Oh, it's just a blown fuse! The lights should come back on! I'm the one that needs to be out there, Margaret.
Uncle Bob, you weren't brave enough to stand up to them in the first place. What makes us think you're gonna do it now?
Because I know the choice, and I don't want to be controlled by fear anymore. And if that means to save you this time, then I will. Should I go?
Oh, no! They need you out there! Quick! Quick!
What's happening?
It's a mess. There's like all these things, and it's crazy, and then there's this other thing, and like this thing ain't it, and these locks on.
Is Randy okay?
Yes. Randy is okay. I don't think you are. I finally got one of you alone. And I'm not a vegan!
Not so fast. My parents told me there'd be a time where you'd come. I am the zombie killer! I have been training since I was just a wee child how to use this bow. It is by no accident that I can hit a pine cone off a tree 5,000 feet away.
Chili! It wasn't spicy enough.
Listen! You come in here, and you think that you can just destroy my family!
Yes, eat them all.
Then I'm going to save my family.
He was one of them!
I have something to tell you guys.
That stupid thermometer thing didn't work!
I'm the zombie killer.
Margaret!
And it's my fault Mom and Dad died! I wasn't there! I wasn't there to kill the zombie!
No, it wasn't your fault, Margaret!
That's why I want to push everything away, because I should have been there. They trained me, they told me, from the day I was born, I had to be...
Don't be hard on yourself, Margaret.
Well, Margaret, look, you killed someone, so make a cry! The cry that apparently you were picked to make and not me!
I hate killing.
So is that what happened, Uncle Bob? You apparently chose her over me?
You knew all along.
I suspected. I've heard of the tale. It was passed down. But I wasn't allowed to reveal it to anyone. Until they revealed it on their own. Until they had the courage to do it. I'm honored to be your uncle.
Come on, Randy. You've earned it.
You have. Roar.
I don't understand why it was you, not me. But now that I see that you have a skill that I could never possess, I think the right choice was made.
This is what I was talking about. We, with you as inspiration, we can all elevate ourselves. Don't you see? Humanity is saved here. Well, let me just board up this board here.
And so. Our tale draws to an end. And what are we to make of it all? That as human beings, we are all a little bit zombie. And all, perhaps, a little bit zombie killer, too. And all just human. But what shall we do with that combustible mixture? My friends, as I send you out into the night tonight, I wish you good tidings, and I wish you deep consideration, because remember, A is for anything can happen. B is for be on guard, because Z is for zombie.
I'm the artistic director at Synergy Theater. Hello, you are an awesome, awesome audience. We appreciate you being here so very, very much. This is the opening night of our brand new show and our brand new season, and you will hear about us out My friends, we're doing Z is for Zombies 7 more times tomorrow night, Saturday, Sunday, and then all next weekend, Thursday through Sunday. If you had a good time, please come back and see it again. It's always brand new, always improvised, and always based on your suggestions. Please tell your friends about us. We'd love to do the show in front of larger and larger audiences all the time. We have some postcards on the table. Please take some on the way out and share them with your friends. Tell them about our show. We have 3 more shows in our entire 23-24 season, which goes all the way through the summer and beyond. And if you would like to see the rest of our season at a ridiculously low price, it is not too late to become a 3-season subscriber. Do we have any subscribers in the audience tonight? Any of our 4-show subscribers tonight? Yay! Oh, thank you, guys. Well, you can see the rest of our 3 shows for just like $57. 3 shows for $57. We have a great lineup for you. Grab some of the postcards on the table. Take a look at what we offer. And please come back. If you have a couple of extra bucks and you wouldn't mind throwing it in our donation bin, we'd appreciate that as well. If you know anyone in the cast and you want to say hello, we're going to be outside by the stage door right after the show. Thank you again for coming and helping us open up Z is to Zombie. Good night, everybody.